error. I gotta check you before you wreck yourself. Look at God. Give God praise for all the teachings of the fall, the faith of God, and rebuilding our communities. And today we enter into a new series entitled LAG, L-A-G, Look at God. We've all heard, so the man thinks, so is he. But this is the reality. Most of what we see is formed, or most of what we think is formed by what we see. What we look at is a major part of our walk of faith. Now, I know someone is saying, but doesn't the Bible say we walk by faith and not by sight? And I'm not disagreeing with what the Word of God says, because we walk by faith, not by sight. But the reality of it is, as we walk by faith, we move according to what we see. And what we see is determined by the amount of faith we will actually release. Because if what we're seeing is negative, we will be confused and we will be held hostage to what we see. So even though we say we have faith, we're not living like people of faith. How often have you declared you got faith until something showed up to challenge your faith and you buckled under the situation because you really didn't have faith, you had lip service? And my goal is not to raise up an army of talkers, but an army of doers. So I'm going to challenge your thought process. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. And faith without works is dead. Therefore, I must hear God's Word to get faith, but my faith is increased when I see God's work. I gotta activate my faith.
Yeah.
Listen, church, just having faith is not enough. Not this season. Not this journey. For what God has in store for you, it's gonna take more than you just saying, I have faith. Because your faith will be tested.
Yes.
You gotta activate your faith. Watch this, for those who need proof. Have you ever received a credit card in the mail? When you receive a credit card or a bank card in the mail, it's your card. The card has purchasing power. But before you can actually use the card, you must activate the card. When you hear the Word of God, you receive faith. But just having faith is like just having an unactivated credit card. You possess it, but it has no purchasing power. And I'm tired of the church having faith with no power. We must activate our faith so we can have the power to go out there and dominate, because God said He created us to dominate. Today I'm going to challenge you to activate your faith. Because I'm tired of seeing people sitting in church with unactivated faith. So they have no real power. They shout. They scream. They run. They speak in tongues. On the inside of the sanctuary of the tabernacle, we lay hands on one another, but we go out there and put our hands down in a defeated mindset, because we really don't have what we say we have. But I come to challenge you to activate your faith so you have the power to remove every demonic spirit that comes against you and your family. Every generational curse shall be broken this season, because your faith shall be activated, and everything that rises up against your family shall be denounced and defeated. Because this season you will not look like you have faith. This season you will have faith, because we will focus on God and look at God. Stand with me if you will. Let's go to the book of Psalms. Psalms chapter 66. Look at verse number 5 and 6. Psalms chapter 66. Look at verse 5 and 6. I give praise to all of my black men and young black men who traveled with me on yesterday to the Black Male Summit in Southwest Houston. We had a marvelous time, and the Lord used us. The Lord used us to such a level that on Father's Day of 2015, the Nation of Islam in Houston called this morning and asked, could the Nation of Islam come and worship at the Greenhouse International Church on Father's Day? Because all the men at the Black Male Summit know, can we go and hear him one more time? Yeah. Give God praise. Psalms chapter, only God can do that.
Yeah.
Oh, so I say, look at God.
Look at God. Like
Psalm 65, verse 5 and 6. David says, come. Psalms chapter 66, verse 5 and 6. I'm still on overdrive of excitement.
Amen.
Come from sickness to exuberation.
Yeah. Yeah.
Come on. Let's start.
I don't know what the devil thought he was going to do. Just made it better.
Yeah.
David says here, we're in Psalm 66, verse 5 and 6. David says here, come and see what God has done, his awesome deeds for mankind. He turned the sea into dry land. They passed through the waters on foot. Come and let us rejoice in him. Take your seat, just have a conversation. Look at God. Look at God. During a difficult season, because you got to understand the backdrop, when David wrote this psalm, he was going through a very difficult season, and not only was he going through a difficult season, the children of Israel were going through a difficult season. They were going through all kinds of problems on every hand, but David sits down and pens this psalm during a difficult season. David says, come and see what God has done. David did not say, let's have a pity party. David did not say, come and let us whine and complain about what's broken, what's going wrong. David says, come and let us see what God has done. Greenhouse, it's time we pause and look at what God has done. It's time we took some time to set aside our problems, our dilemmas, our situations, and just start giving God praise for all he has already done. And I don't care what your walk is right now, where you are in your level of faith, you cannot deny that God has still been good to you. You may be going through something right now. You may have lost your job, may have lost a loved one. Your relationship may be in trouble. You may be going through a season of sickness, but in spite of whatever you're going through, if you really close your eyes and thought about your situation, it could be a whole lot worse. For a matter of fact, somebody you know went through the same thing you're going through right now, and they lost their mind. They committed suicide. They got locked up. They never bounced back. But somehow, some way, God woke you up this morning, and you still got your right mind. You may be hurt in the heart. Your mind may be confused, but you still got your right mind. It could be worse. So can we just pause for a second and give God some praise? Let's look at all the Lord has already done. King David, the songwriter and the musician, tells us three things here we can see God doing. David says, look at God, the miracle worker. Look at God, the miracle worker. And if God was a miracle worker, God is a miracle worker, because the Bible says, tell them that I am sent you. That means I never changed. So if God was ever identified as a miracle worker, you got to tell your situation right now, I serve a God that's a miracle worker. Look at the miracle worker performing a miracle in my life. What are you looking at right now? Are you looking at a negative situation, or are you looking at a miracle worker? No matter how hard your thing is right now, no matter what you're going through right now, if you make your mind up, I'm not going to focus on it, I'm going to focus on God, and watch how God perform a miracle in your situation. We were transparent in here. I'd had somebody to jump up who was on their way to divorce court, and somehow the miracle worker restored your marriage, and now your marriage tight and solid. I wish I had somebody that was transparent. You stood before a judge, knew you was guilty of sin, yet they let you go home because God is a miracle worker. I wish I had somebody off in here and sickness got in your body, and the same thing you got killed your girlfriend, yet God killed you in that situation. I wish I had somebody that can testify that God is still a miracle worker. Not only does David the psalmist, the musician, say that God's a miracle worker, he says, look at God reverse their situation. They were facing a situation, a large body of water, and the enemy was coming after them once again, and the water was high, and they couldn't go through the water. So the Bible says God reversed their situation. What would have drowned them, God dries it up. God reverses their situation. They were dealing with a water situation, and God gave them a dry situation. What am I trying to say? What is David saying right here? David said, look at God. He can reverse that thing around. God can reverse that situation. God can reverse that problem. God can reverse that curse. God can reverse that dilemma. Whatever you're going through right now, look at God and start declaring, God, I know you can reverse it. Because you turn water to dry land. If you can reverse that stuff, God, I know you can reverse my stuff. I dare you right now to shout that God can take a ghetto boy and make him an astronaut. Oh, yesterday I saw a ghetto boy with a 2.1 GPA. Now he owns an aviation company, flying aircrafts all across the country. He flies Beyonce, he flies Jay-Z, he flies all the stars around the world. He graduated with a 2.1 GPA. He went before a judge, he got in trouble, and God turned his situation around. God reversed his situation, B. He went from thug to pilot, and from pilot to own the pilot whole company. He owned aircrafts. Now, don't tell me what God can't do. Your situation. You may be in trouble right now, but God can take your trouble and turn your trouble to a testimony. I wish I had somebody, and you know you're not who you are right now. Who you are right now don't look nothing like you used to look. God reverse your situation.
Jesus.
You went from no confidence to now your swag on 10.
Jesus.
From barely getting out of high school, now you got PhDs. From baby mama to mother.
Jesus.
And then David says here, he says, look at God empowered him to walk through what could have or should have drowned him. I pray I can get through this without shouting. David says, look at God empowered them. Because I love this word empower, because my desire is to empower an army to take the community. My desire is to equip you with the right ammunition to give you the right word, not to get you emotional riled up, but to get you riled up in the fact that you can do all things through Christ which strengthens you. To get to the point where you're no longer walking around with your head down, but you empowered to take your life back. You empowered to change your destiny. You empowered to leave a legacy that's worth leaving. So David says, look at God. He empowered them to walk through what could have and should have drowned them. I don't think you get what I'm saying right now. The water was so deep, and the water wasn't just deep. The water was raging. The water was rough. The water was in a situation where they tried to swim through it, you drowned. And they didn't have a boat. They didn't have a ship. They didn't have an ark. They had no way of getting through the raging sea. But God dried the sea up and let them walk through what was designed to drown them. What you're going through right now is designed to drown you. Those bills were designed to drown you. That divorce should have drowned you. That sickness should have drowned you. That lie told on you should have drowned you. When they stabbed you in your back, that should have drowned you. When your mama didn't show up, that should have drowned you. When your daddy didn't show up, that should have drowned you. When all hell broke loose in your life, that should
should have drowned you. That should have been your Katrina. That should have been your Allison. That should have wiped you out. When you lost that job, you should have drowned. When you smoked that stuff, you should have drowned. When you got hooked up, you should have drowned. Yet the Lord allowed you and empowered you this season to walk through what should have drowned you. I wish I had some faith walkers in here this morning. I wish I had somebody who made your mind up. Look at God. He has empowered me to walk through stuff that should have taken me out.
Thank you.
And David says, let us come.
Yes.
Let us come. Mm-hmm. Let us come.
Yes, yes.
And rejoice.
Yeah. Rejoice
in him.
Yeah.
David said, I don't need nobody to boost me up this season. I don't need a praise team to give you praise this season. I don't need a drummer and an organist to hit the right note this season. When I look at God, it'll make me rejoice. When I look at God and look back over my life, it'll make me rejoice. Is there anybody off in here that when you look back over your life and you look at where you're at right now and you look at God, in spite of every bad decision you've made, in spite of every mistake you've made, in spite of every time you fumbled the ball or dropped the ball or misplayed your head, yet God kept you in the game. I wish you had some grateful believers in the house. I wish you had somebody that wasn't so stuck on yourself that you could admit, if it were not for the grace of God, there go I. If it were not for the grace of God, I wouldn't be here this morning. So when I look over my life and I look at God, that make me rejoice, that make me get happy, that make me jump, that make me run, that make me scream, that make me rejoice, because I know it ain't about me. Look at God.
Jesus.
Can we pause for a few seconds? Stand, would you?
Jesus.
I thank you, God. Close your eyes. You're in a safe place. No one can rob you. And don't you be transparent with yourself. Close your eyes and think about your worst nightmare. Your worst mistake.
Thank you.
Your worst era. And how God
brought you through. Yes.
Stepped in.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Covered you. Yes. Protected you.
Thank you.
And brought you through. Yes.
Thank you.
And he would not share what you went through with anybody.
Thank you.
Open your eyes and give God praise.
Thank you.
You knew what you were praising God for, they probably moved from sitting by you. Yet God didn't expose you. God dealt with you in the dark. God dealt with you in the private until he got you in the right position. Now you're standing and you can say, look at God.
Thank you, Lord God. Thank you.
Each month, each at the beginning of every month, the intercessors, prayer warriors, the Greenhouse International Church contact me requesting what's the prayer focus for the month. What you want to focus on. And I usually give them whatever the subject matter is, whatever the Spirit is tugging in my spirit that we need as a family. But this month when they contacted me, I responded, I'm sure they thought in a very strange response. I said, this month I don't want the intercessors to pray for nothing.
Okay.
I want us to thank God for everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I want us to stop asking God for anything.
Thank you. Yeah.
And pause for a season and do nothing but thank God for what He's already done. Praising for the fall, we're already. But also not familiar with the fall, that's the favor of God. And we got so much favor in this house, we got to pause for a second and do nothing but put our hands together and thank God for this season of favor. Favor produces lag.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
We go from F-O-G to L-A-G. The favor of God, the look at God. Mm-hmm. But we can't be selfish.
Yeah.
Can't be like little Pookie and them. Always got our hands out. Gimme, gimme, gimme.
Yeah.
Sometimes you gotta close your hands and put them together and say, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm making a point to thank everyone.
Thank you,
God. At this church,
thank you, God.
That serves in any capacity, I say thank you for everything. I don't care if you had me a piece of paper, I say thank you. Because you didn't have to. And the truth is, God didn't have to either. But because He loves you, He keeps on doing it. So can we pause for a second in the midst of it all and just tell God thank you?
Thank you, God.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
I know I hear you. Yes, somebody sit and say, Pastor, all that fog is cool in your night, but man, I ain't going through that season right now. I'm going through it right now. I'm going through a difficult season right now, Pastor. I'm not hating on you and your fog, but Pastor, my fog is real foggy. I'm going through some hell right now. Everything is in trouble in my life. And I'm not trying to minimize. Hey, hit me now, hit me now. I'm not trying to minimize your problems. But I'm trying to encourage you to stop looking at your problems so much and to look at God a little closer.
Because
the closer you look at God, you'll start realizing you've been maximizing your problems and minimizing God. Because the more you look at God, you'll realize how God is working those problems out, how God is using those problems as platforms for your next promotion, how God's taking those problems and working out in your favor. See, if you keep looking at the problems, you won't see the favor that's trailing the problems. With every problem, I believe every problem comes with a promise to solve that problem. But I gotta look at God to get the answer to my problem. When I look at my problem, I'm stuck in my problem. But I go outside my problem and look at God, because when I look at God, I get my answer, because He's still the answer. I want you to look at your problems to get you stuck. But your pastor tells you to look at God, because He's already working your problems out. Can I be transparent? Okay. It was that Saturday. They called me with a prayer request. I said, don't pray. Don't ask for nothing. Just praise God. And hold things. That sounds so spiritual. And then Sunday morning, Pastor woke up not feeling 100%. Mm-hmm. But I couldn't back down.
All right.
So instead of saying, God, fix this situation, I said, God, thank you for the opportunity to go minister on today. So I didn't pray for God to remove the situation last Sunday morning. I said, God, thank you for the opportunity to go and be used by you. And I ran in here with a problem. I ran in here with a sickness. I ran in here with vertigo. But I preached like, I preached like Steph Curry in the fourth quarter with the Holy Ghost. The vertigo had intensified and increased. Several of you asked me, Pastor, what is vertigo? Vertigo is a type of dizziness in which the person inappropriately experiences the perception of motion sickness, usually a spinning motion,
disruption of the vascular system is often associated with nausea and vomiting, as well as balance disorder causing difficulties with standing or walking. I had all that at the level 10. Room spinning, earth spinning, throwing up everywhere, couldn't stand up yet. I started declaring, God, I'ma keep on keeping on. I couldn't do nothing for myself, but God, I said, I looked at my calendar on Tuesday. I gotta speak at the graduation. My wife said, baby, you can't go. I said, I'm going. She said, but you can't stand up. I said, but God can. And we want you to shake every hand. I'm dizzy. Can't stand up. I stood and shook 470 hands after giving a message that empowered them to dream the dream of a dreamer. I stood there, shook every hand. I spoke with power and authority. And I declared to the parents at the graduation, I'm going to take this community by force. Ceremony was a part of my speaking bucket list. I had to do it. But then I had to do it because God told me a long time ago He would empower me to stand, not just in the church, but I'd stand in all kind of arenas declaring, look at God. But what if I would have won? I'm just being transparent with you.
Come on, man.
Tell us so. Come
on. So next morning, it's worse. Wake up and you have to call Brother Mike. I said, man, I know. You guys used to be hearing me talk like this, but I need help. I can't get to the hospital. I'm in bad shape. But God is good. Come pick me up and take me to the hospital so I can soothe my wife's nerves. I got to the ER. She looked in. They ran to us and said, before I even gave my name, come on to the back. Mike was like, what kind of stuff is this? I said, look at God. Before I feel like any form, then I already had hooked me up. Because God had worked it out before I even got there. So when I got on the table, he put that little ugly gown on. I said, Mike, give me my phone. I took a selfie in the ER with a big old smile saying, vertigo can't stop me from smiling. Look at God. See, I made my mind up that I'm going to be an example how to deal with positivity and negativity. If I can stand before you and tell you how I got invited to the Astros game to sit with the owner, if I can tell you how Mayor R. Kelly is calling my phone for endorsements, if I can tell you how Steve Harvey's lawyer called me last night saying, Pastor, you moved me on yesterday. If I can share all that with you, I can share the bad stories too. But even the bad stories, I can tell you, look at So I go through stuff too. I just go through it differently. But I don't have a different calling card. The same number you die to get to God, the same number I die.
That's right.
I just die with a different level of faith. But I've been challenging you this morning to pump up your faith and look at God. Go with me. I'm almost done. Go back to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 3. Go back to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 3. That was just the introduction to this series. Acts chapter 3. Let's stand to read in God's word. I pray you're being blessed. We're going to take this community. We're going to take it and reverse every curse in this community.
Amen.
I'm not going to apologize for being aggressive and taking what belongs to the kingdom. We're going to walk in power and authority. I'm tired of seeing little black boys and brown boys struggle and suffer because they got to look to the TV screen and the football field and basketball court for a role. Someone they can't touch. I want to create real life role models here. The little black boys and brown boys can touch and say, I can be like them. Yeah. Acts chapter 3, verse 1. One day, Peter and John was going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. Now a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those who were going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, look at us. So the man gave him his attention, expecting to get something from them. Take your seats. Peter and John said, look at us. I wonder today how many of us can declare to someone in trouble, look at us. Or do we turn our backs and say, we can't help you? Or can we declare, look, say it with me, look at us.
Look at us.
We see here three men, as I run to a close, three men, but we got to take the liberty today to run to a Baptist close, so I may close 3-4 times. We see here three men. One man was lame from birth. One man was lame from birth. You see in your Bible says the man was lame from birth, which means the man had never walked on his own. And there's some men in here and some women in here that have never walked on their own. They've never been able to stand on their own. And I told you, one of the attacks of vertigo is not being able to stand on your own. You get so dizzy, you lose your equilibrium, but you can't stand on your own. You gotta hold on to something. You gotta lay down all the time. And I couldn't imagine being born like this. I couldn't imagine never being able to walk on my own, because we walk by faith, not by sight. But can you imagine never being able to get up and walk, never being able to walk to the ice box, never being able to walk to the restroom, always needing somebody to help you get from point A to point B? I'm too temperamental to have to depend on somebody like that. I'm thanking God right now, but this man never was able to walk by himself. That's a spiritual, physical condition. We see a physical condition, but we're dealing with a spiritual condition at the same time. But there's a lot of men here that never been able to pray for themselves. And I don't care how strong you are, you ain't be able to jump, dunk a ball, and run real fast. But if you can't pray for yourself, brother, you lame. Because a man that can't pray for himself can't take care of himself. Not only has the man never been able to walk on his own, the man has been depending on others to carry him. Can you imagine the attack of the male ego? Somebody got to carry you to the potty. Somebody got to carry you to the kitchen table. Somebody got to carry you to your favorite seat to watch Sports Center. Can you imagine the attack of the male ego? Everywhere you go, somebody got to carry you. Can you imagine, brother, you're a single brother, and you see a fine woman, and you got to call your homeboy to carry you, to holler at her? Think about it. They carry you. Hey, girl. We laughing, right? But that's as crazy as you sitting in the back seat, rolled up to a chick walking down the street, and your homeboy driving, and you rolled up. What's my, hey girl, what's your number? That's just as lame as the lame, man.
Okay.
And she real lame. She give you a number.
Yes.
That's it. Well, they didn't get so
far.
No, we see the man was at the mercy of others supporting him. He had to ask somebody. Every for what he needed. That's real lame, right? Watch this hidden message. There's an agenda in America to make the black man and the brown man so lame, he got to depend on the system to give him everything he wants. That's why they're creating laws to give every black boy and every brown boy a felony so he can't get a good job. So he got to depend on grown man, got to depend on his mama or some sugar mama to take care of him. That's why the system, see, why you shout in church, they creating laws that's giving your little boy stripes to keep him dependent on the system. And a little boy get tired of asking his mama for something to eat, or asking his woman for something to eat, then he go take something to eat, then he get another strike. So now he's two times, so now third strike is gone. And do you know the Constitution of the United States of America says that slavery is still good if you incarcerated? When a man's incarcerated, he's considered legally a slave. So the system sets it up to trip your boys up, so your boys get locked up, and that's free labor. America was built up of 245 years of free slave labor. Now there's no more slaves, so now they're locking us up to enslave us all over again. And we shout.
That's good.
The man with the mercy of others supporting him. But then watch this. I see two other men. They were G-men. From the Greenhouse International Church. Because this man, this lame man, had put his hope in the wrong place. These other two men, Peter and John. You be Peter, you be John. Peter and John. They tell the man, look at us. But what they're really saying, because look at us sound kind of arrogant and everybody can't have that. So what they're really saying, let me interpret what they're really saying is, look at God. Because Peter and John wasn't standing, because Peter and John both used to be lame too. So they say, look at us. They're really saying, look at God, because it's the power of God that got us standing right now. Because if I recall, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, I once was blind. So everybody got a lame story. And don't let no church going hypocrites make you feel lame, because they going to church and you outside the church. Everybody got a story. Peter says, look at us. Because Peter knew if it wasn't up for God. Because when Peter found Jesus, he was ready to run. Peter said, Jesus, you must not know about me. I'm messed up from the flow up. And Jesus said, let's go change the world. Peter hooked up with Jesus. And the Simon and Peter start being pushed back. And Peter stepped up to the plate. But even though Peter was working for Jesus, he still had some Simon inside of him. And when pressure came, Peter started cutting folks like Keisha and them. Peter started cussing folks out and denying Jesus. But Jesus never denied Peter. So Peter was able to tell the lame man, I understand your situation, but look at us. In other words, look at God. Because if God can use Peter, then God can pick the lame man up. And I need some believers in this house to be like Peter and John. Well, what's John's story? John got caught up in the ego game. You remember John and his brother, they start jacking for position with the disciples, start saying crazy stuff like, who's the greatest amongst us? See, the devil can't trip you up. He'll try to boost you up to make you feel like you better than somebody else. I don't care how much God bless me, I'll never get an attitude that I'm any better than anybody else. I stood before hundreds of men and young men on yesterday, and I declared, I'm just an old thug saved by the Lord. I took control of the word thug. I told them, I'm talented, I'm hard to be defeated, I'm unique, and I'm gifted. So I got some thug in me. So
there.
Stand up. Stand up. Point to yourself. My wife and I have been blessed this fall. We're going on vacation to Europe. Somebody else paid for it. And so she's been going on the computer looking at pictures of beautiful sights, beautiful ocean sights, and historical land pieces that God created. Look how beautiful it looks. Look how beautiful the water is. Look how pretty the trees are. Look how pretty this is. Look at night, how the moon. And all that's beautiful. But the creation you point to is the greatest creation God ever created.
Yeah.
You're more beautiful than the rising stars. You're more beautiful than the raging sea. See, that's why Peter and John can say, look at us. Because God created us. And no matter what we went through, Peter denied Jesus, but Jesus never denied Peter. That's the beauty of it all. John started tripping, but Jesus never started tripping with him. And if God can take John and Peter to bless a lame man, he's waiting a day for you to come to him just as you are. You may even be led almighty. You may even be the lame man, and we'll deal with his situation next week. You may even be a lame man, but guess what? When you run into true believers, you can't stay down. Get up, man. See, fake church folks, never down, man. Look at it. We from the same neighborhood. I ain't had my dad either. I went to college. I didn't get on that stuff. I ain't get locked up. See, he should have been more like me. He should have did what I did. See, that's how, you see, they ain't got time for them kind of folks. I need some folks that, man, I understand. Either I've been there, or if it were not for the grace of God, I'd still be there. So let me help you up, brother. Because I understand your story.